Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Mrinmoy Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today, we will discuss a module on Māori plays of the South Pacific, Honekauke, Naga Tangata Toa. The module is prepared by Dr. Devashri Dattarai, Professor, Jadavpur University. Originating in Polynesia and sharing features with languages from the eastern parts of the South Pacific, such as Rarotongan, Tahitian, and Hawaiian, Maori language has flourished in New Zealand for over 1,000 years. The language of today developed with the occupation of Aotearoa by Eastern Polynesian immigrants in AD 800. The language has variations across the South and North Island communities. And within the North Island indigenous communities, the language differs across East and West. Though in all cases, the language is still mutually intelligible. However, given the impact of colonization and the hegemonization presence of the English language, Maori language suffered a crisis until recent years. Where there has been a concerted and sincere effort towards a rejuvenation and revival of the language as a living practice, learning programs, concerned linguists and activists, and New Zealand's official policy to have Maori as an official language are all reasons of the survival of the language in its present form today. Maori today thrives as the language in street signs, cultural gatherings, oral traditions, as well as modern publications of children and adults. Maoris have a strong oral tradition as well as integral to their Polynesian heritage. The oral is a part of a ritualistic tradition which upholds the Maori way of life through diverse knowledge system, genealogy, incarnations, incantations, rituals, song, prose narratives, and dance encapsulate the various ramifications of oral tradition. The tradition is founded upon a common heritage preserved by various communities in Aotearoa. Oral texts were composed, memorized, and narrated with ceremony and religious rituals. Each occasion merited the observation of songs, chants, and complex overviews on the indigenous world. The oral tradition is a living experience of Maori life since it is intimately connected to the idea of performance and spiritual existence. The beginning of Maori writing script may be ascertained from the works of a lay reader of the Church Missionary Society, a Cambridge scholar, and two Maori chiefs in 1820. The Williams family of clerics and missionaries promoted the use of the written script and devised the structure and vocabulary. The Maori English Dictionary, entitled A Dictionary of the New Zealand Language and a Concise Grammar, to which are added a selection of colloquial sentences in 1844, which after revision, 7 editions and a new title, A Dictionary of the Maori Language, 7th edition, 1971, were produced by Williams Wild, and the compilation of the grammar book with the title First Lessons in the Maori Language with a Short Vocabulary in 1862, with later editions revised by his son Herbert W. Williams. In 1969, linguist Bruce Biggs authored the seminal book on Maori Linguistic System and Pedagogy, entitled Let's Learn Māori. Biggs also wrote the complete English Māori dictionary in 1981, which largely comprises the English meanings taken from the Māori headwords and Williams dictionary. Further, new words and terms were also recorded in phenomenal H.M. Nagata's English Māori dictionary in 1993. The second half of the 20th century witnessed a large number of publications on Māori language and teaching, such as John Moorfield's series of Te Wanaka 1987 to 2002 and the linguistic analysis of Winifred Bauer, Māori 1993. Cleve Burlew's translation of Biggs' Let's Learn Māori as Me Ako Tauto I Te Reo Māori 1990 is one of the first major works on Māori language in Māori. Initial written literature in Māori reflected the religious and political proclivities of the church and state and their imperialist aspirations. Howard W. Williams, A Bibliography of Printed Māori to 1990, which was published in 1924, provides a well-documented resource on such publications. As the written script established itself, the Bible, orders of service, hymns, and church doctrines were translated into Māori. Further, government-aided publications disseminated information on British and European cultural, political, and social history and policy to Māori readers in Māori. As government, churches, philanthropists, activists promoted the use of Māori language to divulge their local and international activities. Māori newspapers flourished in the 19th century. Newspapers also became the medium of protest used by Māori individuals. The Māori Parliament and members of the Māori King movement to express resistance against colonial rule since the 1850s. Also, letters from Māori people to government officers, records of tribal meetings and minutes of the Māori land court constitute significant unpublished material in Māori and also provide evidence on crucial linkages between oral traditions and the written script. Therefore, since the 1840s, personal records of indigenous history, customary practices, genealogies, songs, proverbs, idioms have been retained in written Māori. However, these have been mostly preserved as private documents rather than for public uses. The decline of the use of Māori, the concerns of making public traditional language, are some of the reasons as to why these documents have not been printed as widely. In recent years, some such personal records have been brought to the public domain and constitute a very rich Māori written tradition as well. Much of oral Māori literature today can be accumulated from public libraries, where 19th century linguists, anthropologists, administrators, folklorists, or missionaries collected the material in the form of genealogy, song of incantations. For instance, Governor Sir George Grey and government official John White obtained similar material from indigenous communities. In Grey's and White's collections are manuscripts by several Māori writers, notably Aperahama Taunui and Uire Mumahi Te Rangi Kaheki. From such material, Grey published in numerous works, including Ko Naga Mahinga a Naga Tupuna, 1854, with a very free English version in Polynesian Mythology, published in 1855. This book contains heavily edited narratives on the creation of human life, legendary heroes, and the settlement of indigenous groups in Atoyaroa. In Ko Naga Moteatiami Naga Hakirara O Naga Māori, 1853, Gray published nearly 500 texts of the song poems. White's 6th volume, Ancient History of the Māori, 1887-90, encapsulates the creation of the gods and human life through the migration and settlement of Aotearoa to the arrival of the Europeans. S. Percy Smith's Māori Words of the 19th Century, 1910, and Eldon Best Monographs on Customary Practices and Indigenous History, 2025, are both books based on informants' data are evidence of the passionate interest in Māori traditions nurtured by Europeans in the early years of the 20th century. The Journal of the Polynesian Society, 1892 onwards, which have been still publishing, is a substantial resource of articles in Māori about indigenous knowledge system. Bilingual text with histories written in English and extensive quotations in Māori have seen the light of the day in the middle of the 20th century, such as J.S. Mitchell's Takitimu, 1944, and John Grace's Tuhare Toa, 1959. The oral indigenous inheritance has been inscribed in the written and published in Māori with English translation as emblematic, and Anaruz Reddy's edition of his ancestors' writings, Naga Korero Amohi Rutopu, 1993, and Pete Hurinui Jones and Bruce Biggs' History of the Tainui People, Naga Ayuitoi Tainui, 1995. From the 1960s, scholars have also published from Māori manuscripts with translation, such as the ethnographic monograph Māori Marriage, 1960, by Bruce Biggs, and the compilation Huri Huringa, 1997, Margaret Orbell's Traditional Māori Stories, 1992, Agatha Thornton's The Story of Maui by Te Rangi Kaheka, 1992. C.R.H. Taylor's comprehensive work, A Bibliography of Publications on the New Zealand Māori, 1972, discuss traditional Māori culture. Jeffrey Sissons, Pat Hohepa, and Wirimu Wihongi's The Puriri Trees Are Laughing, 1987, discusses indigenous history while Māori knowledge systems are revised in Margaret Orwell's Hawaiki, A New Approach to Māori Tradition, 1985. Agatha Thornton offers a comparative study of Māori and Greek literature in Māori oral literature, 1987. Well-known Māori writers such as Patricia Grace and Katerina Matera have produced books for children to learn Māori. Clive Barlow published a bilingual edition on cultural concepts, Tikanga Wakangaro, 1991. Companion volumes to the Dictionary of New Zealand Biography was published as Naga Tangata Taumata Rao, 1992-2000. Books were written about individual lives. The Minister, Hemi Potato's autobiography He Hokinga Mahara, 1991, Ruka Broughton's told the story of his ancestor, Naga Mahi Wakaria Titokuaru, 1993. Elders published the unpublished articles, and letters were edited by Uirimu and Tōhorereka, 1994 and 1996, and 19th century newspaper correspondence was reproduced with translation by Margaret Orbell in He Reta Kite Monga. Some texts have also been an important part of Māori cultural tradition. D.S. Long and V.T. Ihimaera, edited Into the World of Light, 1982, dedicated to life and works of composer Twini Nanguai. Again, Twini, Her Life and Her Songs, 1985, has been compiled by Ngoi Pihorangi. Song texts have also been published in the Penguin Book of New Zealand Verse 1985 and the Penguin Book of Contemporary New Zealand Poetry in 1989, both edited by Harvey McQueen and Ian Wade, and in Margaret Orwell's Waita, Maori Songs in History, 1991. Song texts are symptomatic of a thriving tradition of performance and a living language that has evolved with contemporary global changes. Performance is an integral part of Maori oral tradition. Storytelling, dance, music, and games were enacted on traditional sites called Wair Tepare, central to Maori society. The Wair Tepare indicated an outdoor location or the base of a tree, which was designated as the space for performance. A Wair Matoro was a form of Wair Tepare that offered entertainment specifically by and for young people in the community. A traveling troupe of entertainers who staged Wair Tepare in a succession of communities was called the Wair Karioi. By the late 19th century, with the onslaught of colonization, Wair Tepare as a tradition was being eradicated with the loss of its associated customs. In 2008, the Orotokare Trust was formed by Charles Royal. The trust aimed at rejuvenating the Wair Tepare tradition by offering a conglomeration of the old performative rituals and new approaches to Maori performing arts. In 2010, the trust held its first Wair Tepare at Waimango Marae, Hauraki. There have been several performances since with the uses of traditional Maori instruments and marionette-type puppets called karetawa, as well as the presence of modern digital soundscape. The dramatic element in Maori forms such as haka were exploited in early New Zealand stage dramas such as The Land of the Mau, The Land of the Moa, 1895, and Tapu, 1903. Maori people were given only minor roles in these productions and were almost never consulted over the script or the staging. The very early feature film entitled Hine Moa, 1914, employed Maori actors, but did not involve Maori expertise on the content. Some of Rudal Hayward's films, such as Rewe's Last Stand, 1940, were exceptional since attempts were made to incorporate Maori viewpoints therein. The ambitious 1941 production of Haine Moa in Rotorua by the Maori Musical Society offer evidence of Maori initiative and demonstration of culture and art. The first New Zealand play reflecting domestic racial relations can be found in Bruce Mason's The Pohutukawa Tree, 1957. While director Richard Campion struggled to find Maori for the lead roles, he was lucky to find Maori actress Hira Tauhare, who gave a powerful performance in the role of the protagonist, Aroha Mataira. In 1971, Te Raukuru, The Feathers of the Albatross, the first play by a Maori playwright, was written by journalist Harry Dancy. The play dealt with the destruction of Te Witi settlement at Parihaka and was first staged with George Hensare as Te Witi at Auckland's Mercury Theatre in 1972. 2 years later, Te Raukura was performed at Wellington's Ngeti Poneka Maria by members of Victoria University's Te Rio musical Mr. King Hongai, first produced at Auckland Mercury Theatre 1973. In 1965, the New Zealand Opera Company performed Porgy and Bess, George Gershwin's opera of African-American life, with Inia Te Waita in the lead and 30 other Maori in the chorus. Several of them, such as Don Selwyn, George Henare, and Apirana Taylor, went on to become leading theatrical personalities. The success of this production led to the establishment of the Maori Theatre Trust. In 1967, the Trust performed a classical drama, He Mana Toa, and a comedy of life before European settlement, The Golden Lover. Both plays paved a new direction and sense of identity in Maori theatre. In 1970, the Maori Theatre Trust embarked on an international tour whereby members first contributed to New Zealand's large-scale pageant at Expo 70 in Osaka, Japan, then toured to Hungary and several cities in the then Soviet Union. The trust eventually disbanded due to the financial crisis. The mid-1970s witnessed a revival of Maori theatre with the rise of Maori political activism. In 1976, Te Eka Amau Players was the first theatre company formed and run by Maori and staged Raule Habib's The Death of the Land. The play toured nationally and it was also rendered for television in 1978. Two founding members of Te Eka Amau, Jim Mauriatri and Brian Potiki, would soon become well-known theatre personalities themselves. In fact, it was Potiki who formed the radical theatre company Maranga Mai, which staged contemporary events from the Maori political movement in 1979. The company toured schools, Mare, and also gave an invited performance at Parliament, at Parliament buildings in Wellington. While they invited much adverse criticism for provoking racial disharmony, but the Maranga Mai also encouraged young Maori to join theatre such as the Samoan actor Etuati Eta. The 1970s saw the emergence of Maori graduates in theatre such as Raviri Paratene from QE to Arts Council Drama School, later the NZ Drama School and Toi Wakari in 1972. Rangi Moana Taylor graduated in 1975 and would then go on to form the Te Ohu Wakari, a Maori theatre cooperative. Through its extensive tours in schools and Marea for 15 years, this group performed stories on the basis of lives of individuals and events in Maori history. Te Ohu Wakari went on to produce plays written by Rangi Moana's brother, Apirana Taylor, and their sister Riuya Brown. Founding member Brian Gray Smith, who was 17 when Te Ohu Wakari was set up, later became a noted playwright. In 1983, the Depot Theatre, later renamed as Takirua, was opened in Wellington with the aim of producing work from New Zealand only. They produced significant Maori plays such as Naga Morihu and Tupuna 1987 and Fragments of a Childhood 1988, all by Raule Habib. The 1990s witnessed the powerful presence of Maori theatre in New Zealand with worldwide recognition. In 1991, John Broughton's passionate monologue entitled Michael James Manaya was first performed by Jim Moriarty at the Edinburgh Festival. In that year, Won Kauka's Naga Tangata Toa, an epic based on Ibsen's The Vikings at Helgeland, was developed in collaboration with Norwegian theatre worker Haldis Hoas. The protagonist Rongomai was played by the brilliant actor Nancy Browning. Carnegie writers, the 1919 Maori society of this play is volatile in ways that resonate with contemporary political concerns. They are a people undergoing the stress of change. Tenato's wife wearing the traditional women's moko or chin tattoo has been content to keep the home fires burning for her warrior's husband. Tero Maori Theatre, which includes Bayer Gray Smith's Waitapu 1996, along with new theatre forms in the 21st century, have moved beyond the agitprop theatre, the Mare-based traditional stories. Taika Waititi, the Jima and Clement, also well known as screen actors and directors, turned legends into irreverent comedy in the Untold Tales of Maui, which toured nationally in 2003 and 2004. Playwrights such as Albert Blaise Awaitapu, Yours Truly, Te Karakia, and Waiti Harekia have dealt with issues not previously seen as intrinsically Maori. In 2010, the first annual Tonga Waikari Maori Playwrights Festival in Auckland include the 24-hour deadline theatre challenge, in which five playwrights had 12 hours to write a 15-minute play, which was performed the following night. In April 2012, six feature-length dramas appeared on television as the series Atomira. Each work had originally been written for the stage by a different Maori playwright. The series was co-produced by Taki Rua as part of an expansion into film and television production. It is evident, therefore, that Maori theatre is a living tradition which reflects the tumultuous changes in Maori society and culture. In the words of Hon Kouka, I think Maori language literature can help strengthen the language. I am working more in that area. And there are great initiatives of more work like drama in Te Reo Māori, the Maori language. Plays in the Maori language and the establishment of Maori television have helped to strengthen the Maori voice. I think not only the word, but putting out any element of Maoridom to the art world is beneficial to all. Maori theatre reflects Maori identity and ethnicity and form a trajectory of the revitalization of Maori language and culture. For further reading, you can consult the Learn More and further reading list, and you can consult the web links provided here with e-text. And for self-assessment, you can consult to the self-assessment document attached with this module. Thank you.